making the Orsay simply an underground station, serving the suburban lines. Meanwhile, the hotel which forms the west facade of the station continued in its gentle decline from great station hotel to slightly shabby tourist stopover. The faded glories of the Salle des Fêtes became a popular place for banquets. But by 1961, the decision had been taken to pull the whole thing down and build a new, modern hotel. A competition was held, and this was the winning entry by René Goulon and Guillaume Gillet. But this was never built. The tide was turning against modern architecture. Modernism was out, conservationism was in. In 1973, the station and its hotel were listed as a historic monument. Meanwhile, another problem was becoming acute. The small Jeu de Paume gallery in the Garden of the Tuileries, which housed the French National Collection of Impressionist paintings, was filled to bursting point with visitors. The solution to both the problems, what to do with the Impressionist paintings and what to do with the railway station, was to found the Orsay as a new museum of 19th century art. This was vigorously supported by the conservative president, Valéry Giscard d'Estaing, and in 1979, a closed architectural competition was held to see how it could be achieved. This is how the winning architect, Pierre Kolbok, of the architectural partnership ACT, saw the problem.
Should we make a pastiche, given that we had decided to add some elements to the station? Or should we make something in sharp contrast, very modern, or perhaps something between the two? An architectural treatment should slide into the railway station like a kind of natural extension of what Lalou, the original architect, created.
And something between the two was what they decided, and this won them the competition. By 1981, a team of curators under the leadership of Michel Laclotte was scouring the catalogues for new works to buy up. The brief was to include architecture, painting, sculpture, photography, and film.
We spent about 3 million francs for certain. 1,015,000 for the Horta, 1,000,000 for the Burne Jones. Incidentally, I've just had a phone call from the owner of the Burne Jones, who's astonished we haven't paid her yet.
Many of the new works they snapped up belonged to the previously despised academic or pompier art.
38,000.
Several were well known as illustrations in art books, but had rarely been seen in public until now. This is Cormon's somber painting of Cain, the talking point of the Salon of 1880. The curators also decided that the building itself would be meticulously restored and put on display as one of the architectural exhibits. But before the museum was open to the public, two important events occurred. First, the interior designer to the museum, Guy Aulenti, began to play an increasingly important role. She adapted the winning ACT design and restructured the interior, giving it a bolder, more obtrusive quality. It's an ironic postmodernist confrontation with the original building. The most noticeable result of her intervention was to make the internal architecture a continual talking point in Parisian cultural circles. The second event was the consequence of the election of the socialist, François Mitterrand, as president of France in May 1981. He supported the museum, but at a price. He insisted that the works of art in it should be placed in their proper historical context. But how could this be done? The Marxist art historian, Madeleine Reberioux, seen here on the right, was appointed as vice president of the museum to find an answer.
C'est autre chose. C'est le moment où l'industrialisation de la société française franchit un pas considérable.
French industrialization brought with it profound social, ideological, and cultural transformation in the arts, which was experienced as a crisis of representation, and a crisis in the finality of the object one produces.
Donc en définitive, on n'a pas osé les mettre ici puisque Monet les avait donnés pour être à leur rangée et on a construit.
But how should the relationship between works of art and the historical context be shown in a museum? These questions were posing serious problems to the curators.
The ambiguity, and it led in the beginning to a virtual confrontation, is that these elements of information are not very visual. Literature, music, politics cannot be shown permanently alongside works of art. And what we have here in this museum are works of art, and there's a contradiction.
Now, whatever else you say about the Orsay, it's a huge popular success. More than 10,000 people a day visit the museum. To test out the contradictions and different intentions embodied in the museum, let's go inside and see how it works in practice.
Who are these people? What do they come for? The sociologist Pierre Bourdieu did some research on museum visitors in the 60s, which showed that art museums serve to increase the sense of alienation of the less wealthy, the less educated, and the provincial. On the other hand, they increase the feeling among the educated, metropolitan middle classes that art belongs to them and is comprehensible. Bourdieu likened the love of art to religious faith. The museum is like a temple. The curators are its priests.
Oui, je crois que l'image qui est dominante.
Yes, I think that the dominant image of the museum is the temple. Despite the best efforts of the architects, they continue to reproduce this idea. Nevertheless, we are trying to shift this image of a museum, firstly by showing it's a place where you can go for a walk. We have tried here to use the architecture of the railway station to show that the museum can be like a kind of city where you can come without a necessarily fixed notion of cultural experience. In other words, to make of a museum somewhere more familiar, a place for a promenade, a meeting place. Why not?
So we can see the main space of the museum as a kind of urban analogy, or a cross-section of French society in the 19th century. Here are the streets and boulevards. The curators call this the Allée Centrale, in reference to the central avenues of the great exhibitions of the 19th century. Furthermore, there are explicit references to the public spaces of Paris. Many of these sculptures were originally displayed in the city. Carpeaux's Quatre Nations was originally set up in the gardens of the Luxembourg Palace. And this is the original of his group, La Danse, commissioned for the facade of the Paris Opera. And at the end of the Allée Centrale, we find a model of the Paris Opera itself. In front is a relief model of the section of Paris in which the opera is situated, thus referring out to the whole-scale urban planning of the Haussmann era. This exhibit links architecture, urbanism, music, opera, and ballet.
Et le fait même que nous nous trouvions dans un bâtiment de l'époque.
And the fact that we find ourselves in a building of the period is extremely original. The museum itself being part of the museum collection.
The most spectacularly rich interior space, the Salle des Fêtes, has been painstakingly restored. Some of the museum's more academic sculptures and paintings are displayed here. This is what the French call Pompier art. It's a vivid example of the clash of interests facing curators. On the one hand, they're fascinated by these works for their historical reference, but they dare not exhibit them with what they see as good art, in case their own taste is called into question. The Orsay staff have dealt with this problem by physically separating Pompier art from good art. The gallery spaces below the terraces on this side exhibit the works of those official artists who opposed the progressives and frequently excluded them from the salon. The other side is supposed to stand for the progressive mainstream, from Daumier and Millet to Manet and the early Impressionists. These are the realist artists associated with the revolution of 1848, branded with anarchist or socialist leanings by the Academy and subsequently excluded from high honours. The Gleaners by Millet, 1857, is one of the most powerful images of working women. But right across the Allée Centrale is a room filled with very different views of women. Plaisanger's Woman Bitten by a Serpent is characteristic of bourgeois academic taste of the Second Empire. And on the next wall, the great success of the Salon of 1863, The Birth of Venus by Cabanel. This room is never short of visitors. Now, it's a commonplace of art historical discourse to compare Manet's Olympia with an official painting like the Venus by Cabanel. In this museum, they're shown separately. So here we have the Olympia shown with other Manets of roughly the same period. And there are some obvious advantages in this approach. This is Manet's portrait of Emile Zola. In its style, color, scale, and handling, it goes well with Olympia. Zola, of course, defended Manet, not least in the book depicted in this painting. So there is a clear expression of solidarity, of belonging to a group.
Nous estimons qu'il faut absolument distinguer les formes d'expression.
Now we believe that you must absolutely distinguish expressive forms. That Manet must be placed in the same section as his comrades, the early Impressionist painters, say people like the young Monet. And Cabanel with his companions from the Salon, Bouguereau, etc. But cohabitation would have been a historic error, almost a betrayal of what the avant-garde was, which remains the most lively creative force of the period, whatever you say.
La force la plus vivante de la création, quoi qu'on dise.
But the way in which people can use a museum is not entirely dictated by the way in which paintings are arranged. For example, here is a booklet produced by the Service Culturel of the museum. It's aimed at 15 to 20-year-olds. It's called Femmes Officielles, Femmes Refusées, literally official women, rejected women. But it's about the way women are represented by official artists on the one hand and the so-called progressive artists on the other hand, the ones who are exhibited in the Salon des Refusés. Now, a book like this one, as this film that we're making, allows for contrast and comparison. So here we have details of the Cabanel contrasted with details of the Olympia. Because these paintings are in different rooms, and museum goers generally buy the museum literature after they've seen the exhibits, they may not be aware of these contrasts. This huge painting is Courbet's Burial at Ornon. Would visitors know why the curators decided to hang a realist painting like this directly opposite an academic painting such as Couture's Romans of the Decadence? On the one hand, It's there because it would be very difficult to find anywhere else to hang it. But to the curator, it also stands for the whole world of official, successful, academic art. It's as if the decadent world represented here stands for bourgeois society. And their taste is reflected in this kind of art. By contrast, the world depicted in Courbet's burial at Ornon and his realist style could be seen as socially and aesthetically progressive. Juxtaposing the Courbet and Couture would produce a third work of art, one created by the curators. To the historian, though, this painting could be seen as representative of a particular phase of bourgeois society.
I think, in fact, that one of the great events of the 19th century is the upheaval caused by the Industrial Revolution. And it's for this reason that I endeavored in vain during my time at the Orsay to place a symbolic object, a railway engine, perhaps, or the Creusot steam hammer, either at the entrance or opposite Couture's Romans of the Decadence. This would show that this kind of art is no longer possible after the Industrial Revolution.
And the explicitness of this analogy between decadent Roman culture and 19th century French taste is made clear by locating behind it a room with the kind of decorative arts which were awarded with official prizes. This metal cabinet from the Deal workshop was exhibited in the International Exhibition of 1867 and displays the bombastic, nationalistic iconography of exhibition art.
Il y a à Orsay un certain nombre de peintures et de sculptures.
There are in the Orsay a certain number of paintings and sculptures which could be called Pompier art in the sense that they belong to a continuing academic tradition. But they are in a minority, and they do not take away from the importance which we give to the great mainstream of avant-garde art.
It is no accident that in the empty, unused roof space of the old railway station, the curators have put the pure, undiluted sequence of the great mainstream, Impressionism, Neo-Impressionism, and Post-Impressionism. This is what most visitors have come to see, the most popular and accessible of paintings for this generation. This kind of work has been legitimated by modernist art historians as autonomous, dealing with purely visual, artistic problems. And that is how they are presented here, entirely out of any historical context. In this part of the museum, people do seem to be working harder than in other spaces. Why is this? Are they responding to the paintings in a purely aesthetic way?
Yes, indeed, the works are presented in an abstract way without information. But we think that visitors need to understand the context in which they were created. And to provide this comprehension, we have installed cards in spaces separate from where the works are hung. For example, for the visitors who want to learn about the geography of Impressionism, that is to situate Impressionist paintings in time and space, they have at their disposal here a card which allows them to analyze the landscape which these painters loved.
Similar information areas or points clés are discreetly sited around the museum, where people can browse and satisfy their curiosity. A compromise reached between Madame Reberiou and the curators was to install some purely historical displays at key points around the building. One, which was originally intended to constitute a compulsory introduction to the visit, is tucked away under the main stairs. Here, the history of the 19th century is represented symbolically by a number of key objects.
Ce qui me gêne, ce n'est pas qu'elle soit vue en entrant ou en sortant. Ce qui me gêne, c'est qu'elle ne soit pas...
What saddens me is not whether the history is seen at the beginning or at the end, or even if it's inserted in the middle. What saddens me is that it is situated on the periphery. Also, that this necessarily invokes a narrowly political image of history, not cultural enough, not socio-cultural enough.
Notre souci ici, c'est de donner à comprendre.
Our concern here is to promote comprehension. And I think that comprehension does not require mechanical explanations. It's up to each person to construct a system of relations between historic events in the political, economic, cultural spheres. And this is a process, I believe, which can never be complete, never give a definitive explanation. But to construct this system of relations is to think, and I think that this is a very important source of pleasure. I think that the pleasure one derives from works of art is proportional to the thought which one's gaze stimulates.